Hey, this is Patrick Sullivan. Welcome to my shop. I love wood. The delicate figure in this quarter saw in white oak, for example. Yet many projects need a few metal parts. Might be something you can buy, like these brass hinges. But periodically, I need something special, like this clasp that I made. I have no training at all in metalwork, and I don't have any of those precision tools that fill machinist shops, like metal lathes, mills, and CNC routers. So, when a project pops up that demands specialized metal parts, do we just have to back away? My latest project involved building a rather specialized camera arm that I plan to use for video work. It's a very clever mechanism, and I will put out a separate video that explains the design and shows its construction. I built parts of it from mahogany, like many old pieces of photography equipment from a century ago. But parts of it beg to be made from aluminum. This video is the story of my attempts to shape aluminum and brass with woodworking tools. Regardless of whether you have any interest in this camera arm, hopefully you can learn something about metalwork in the woodshop from my experience and mistakes. The first step almost inevitably involves sawing. Colin Furze would use a plasma cutter. And this old Tony might use a big milling machine. But we woodworkers will use what we have, saws. Wait, I hear you saying. Isn't that going to ruin the blade or overheat the metal? That can't be safe. In fact, both table saws and miter saws can cut aluminum and brass easily. They use blades with carbide tips. Tungsten carbide is much, much harder than these soft metals. You don't need to worry about the cutting edges on your blades. However, it is possible to screw it up. Aluminum may not be extremely hard, but it is amazingly strong. I can't demonstrate this on my saw stop for two reasons. First, the safety mechanism will immediately trip if I try to cut conductive material. And second, this would be stupidly dangerous. Watch what happens when I jam this 1/8 inch or 3 millimeter strip into the blade very rapidly. The aluminum can advance all the way into the gullet between the teeth. When the next tooth engages, it will take a huge bite, and the cutting edge may not impact the aluminum surface first. Remember how strong aluminum is? When I did this a few years ago, the resulting force actually broke the entire tooth off the saw blade. Not just the carbide tip, the whole tooth. Big noise, damp underwear, and way more excitement than I bargained for. I would just as soon not repeat this. The moral of this tale is that slow feed rates are smart. The bigger the gullets, the larger the risk with thin metal stock. Can you see how much of a difference there is between this 24-tooth rip blade and this 60-tooth finish blade? Choose blades with as many teeth as possible and advance the work through the blade slowly and evenly. For the kind of shapes I needed for my camera arm, the bandsaw seemed like the best choice. I know, you're going to tell me that woodworking bandsaw blades travel at way too fast a speed for metal. This is a woodshop myth that you hear all the time. In fact, industrial shops cut aluminum with bandsaws that travel even faster than woodshop saws. I don't care what speed your bandsaw runs at. It makes no important difference when cutting softer metals. Now, stainless steel is a whole different story. Slow is critically important there. What about the blade? Well, you can cut aluminum and brass with ordinary blades. The blades will get dull faster than they would if they were used exclusively on soft woods, but that doesn't happen instantly. Just as with wood, the number of teeth should be inversely proportional to the thickness of your stock. I purchased a bimetal blade designed for cutting soft metals. The teeth are hardened, high-speed M2 steel, while the rest of the blade is a softer, springier steel. It has a variable 8 to 12 teeth per inch, or 3 to 4 teeth per centimeter. It works like a charm, and it didn't cost much more than an economy blade. I hate changing the bandsaw blade, so when I have some quick cuts in wood, I often just leave the bimetal blade on. For example, I resawed this piece of African mahogany. It took about a minute. The cut is so smooth that it's very difficult to even show the blade marks. Now, don't get me wrong. If I have a big resawing project, I will switch the blade. A 3 teeth per inch skip tooth blade will cut faster and will clear sawdust better than this metal cutting blade for very deep cuts. But for odd jobs and thinner material, it's not a bad compromise. Incidentally, my scroll saw will also cut aluminum, as long as you install a blade designed for metal. It's not nearly as fast as the bandsaw, but it can handle very tight curves. I used it to cut the curved shapes on the box catch in this photo. My camera arm design needed 2 plates made from thick aluminum. I wanted rounded outer and inner corners, and I needed a slot in both plates. My solution for these parts was to cut the shapes a little oversized on the bandsaw. And then route the final shapes by following a template. I cut the templates from 6mm MDF. MDF is a near-perfect material for patterns, in my opinion. I can cut out the shape very quickly with a whole variety of tools and sand exactly to my design lines in minutes. A disc sander or a strip sander makes especially fast work of it. However, it's just hard enough for the router bearing or the bushing to follow the template precisely. Any router bit will cut aluminum, but I just never bother with steel router bits for any routing work anymore. I either use carbide tipped or solid carbide bits exclusively now. You can use any of the bit styles shown here. Chinese factories are producing carbide bits of reasonable quality at prices that are not much higher than plain steel bits. And the carbide stays sharp way, way longer. These plates are a little too small to hand hold safely. I clamped a large scrap of plywood to my workbench. I attached the aluminum plate to the plywood base with both double-sided tape and screws. I then attached the template to the aluminum with more of the tape. A bushing in the router base will follow the template. The template has to be made slightly smaller to account for the difference between the radius of the bushing and the radius of the bit. If you make the template design on a computer, it's an easy task to shrink the template lines down by the required amount. A straight bit, and even a small router, will trim the aluminum plate to the exact size and will leave a pretty clean edge. However, I'm making this look a little more foolproof than it really is. First, cutting thick aluminum produces a lot more vibration than cutting wood. Every time a flute of the bit hits the aluminum, a shock is transmitted through the bit to the router. This happens 300 to 400 times per second, something like the vibrations in an impact driver, but about 5 to 6 times as fast. It's hard to see this vibration in the video, but you can feel it and hear it. Look at this bolt in the router base. See it vibrating loose? Vibration loosens every threaded fastener on the router, including the collet that holds the bit. I'm embarrassed to say that I've had the bit loosen multiple times while routing very hard material. This changes both the depth of the cut and the precision. The solution seems to be to over-tighten the collet when you install the bit and then recheck the tightness after every few minutes of high vibration routing. Notice also that when the bit is buried in the slot, the chips pack into the slot very tightly. You typically cannot vacuum them out without first prying them loose. Stop after every pass, dig out the chips, and check the tightness of the collet and any other threaded fasteners like the bushing. I mentioned the bushing because mine vibrated loose and the bit cut right through one side of it. This not only ruins the bushing, but it also ruins the workpiece because it allows the bit to move closer to the pattern. The result was that the slots that I was trying to cut to a precise width ended up wider than I wanted. I decided to accept this poor result for the time being, with plans to remake the entire piece later. If the router leaves a few chatter marks on the edges, you can clean these up with 400 grit sandpaper very quickly. A disc sander or a strip sander makes fast work of it, but hand sanding is not a big chore. I wanted a pair of small brass pointers to slide in the slots in the aluminum plates. I needed first to cut a deep step in both sides of a strip of brass, with the center portion a good fit for the slot that I just made. I was willing to hand-hold the brass because I left the workpiece attached to a long strip which I could manage much better than tiny pieces, and because the router bit was buried in its fence. I started off taking ultra-thin cuts, probably less than half a millimeter. By the end, I'd gained enough confidence in my setup to make passes that were 3 to 4 times that thickness. I drilled a hole through which an 8mm threaded rod would pass, and then cut the piece to size and shape on the bandsaw. A little work with a file and some sandpaper finished the job. I also tried my hand at using the router to engrave lines that guide the alignment of the mechanism. I made a jig that guided the router in a straight line and kept it square to the workpiece. In the end, I was disappointed because I felt that the V-bit I used was much too thick. I have since acquired a couple of carbide bits with much finer points. My results on the metalwork part of this project were far from perfect, and I'm not holding them out as an example of master craftsmanship. Nevertheless, I'm actually quite pleased to find out that I could cut and shape chunks of aluminum as thick as these. The ability to make some metal parts made it possible for me to take on this challenging and extremely interesting project. It's also given me the confidence to consider some designs that go well beyond the typical home shop projects. For instance, my daughter is interested in traditional large format photography as it was practiced more than 100 years ago. I'd like to build one of the gorgeous wood and metal view cameras from that era. These were complex pieces of equipment and demand respectable precision, but successfully building one would be extremely satisfying. I hope you can see that metal shaping can be done with woodworking tools. If you have some patience and persistence, you can produce beautiful and precise metal parts for your woodworking projects. Please work safely. Getting hit by a flying piece of metal can be much more damaging than being hit by wood chips. The forces involved in shaping metal can surprise you in the blink of an eye. Don't get careless or complacent for even a minute. As always, thanks for watching.